worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. The Buddha's speech on friendliness. What should the clever one advantageously do to attain this state called peace is this. He should be intelligent, straight, honest, humble, gentle, and never proud, contented and easy to support, not busy, careful, and silenced, in abilities and senses, cautious and modest, neither flattering families nor be demanding, not doing even a minor trifle that other wise men might criticize. Then he should think, may all beings be joyous and safe. Let every creature's mind rejoice. Whatever breathing beings there are, no matter whether feeble or firm, with none excepted, whether long, tall, big, medium, short or small, whether seen or unseen, visible or not, whether living far away or near here, whether existing or just about to come into being, let every living being's mind be exultantly jubilant. Let no one ever kill or another being undo, nor ever harm anyone anywhere at all. Let no one wish even a minor bad for another, neither from provocation nor from revenge. Thus, as a mother with her own life might guard her only baby child, thus should he maintain a mentality of infinite friendliness for every living being, in gentle sympathy for this entire universe, unlimited, endless, and waste. As above, so below, and all around, unimpeded, without any hatred, purged of all enmity, whether standing, walking, seated, or lying down, while slumbering, he should always maintain such awareness of gentle and benevolent kindness. This very mentality is the divine dwelling here, they say. He that do not traffic with many speculative views, perfected in seeing what is right and wrong, purged of lusts for sense pleasures, he will surely not come back here to any womb.
Hello to you, friends. Yet another little forest monk walk and talk here in the mountain jungle. One should never let a good opportunity to share the Dhamma or to assist the Dhamma go pass by unnoticed or unutilized. So here we are again before it starts raining. Here's a good spot, so I think we sit down here. The subject today is three poems from the Tipitaka, and we remember the Sutta Pitaka, the middle part of the Buddhist Bible on 56 volumes, is the part that all Buddhist monastic and lay should read three times before their death moment. And the middle part, the Sutta Pitaka, the middle basket of text, of suttas, of threads, of something that streams into the ear and becomes information in the mind, a serious software update, This contains five Nikayas, five text collections, where the little one, the little finger, which actually is fairly large text-wise, is a collection of minor texts. And the second book in that, a fairly thin one, is the Dhammapada. Of 423 poems of the Buddha and his enlightened monks. And today we will discuss three of them that I find particularly expansive, broad, and also very teaching, good teachings. It's number 277 to 279. And it goes like this. All constructions, all phenomena are impermanent, not lasting, transient. They come and go. Whoever sees that, understands that through wisdom, and turns away from what is ill, from what is bad, from what is wrong, then this becomes the path to purity. All constructions, all formations, all things that are put together, all things that have a cause, are suffering, are bad states, are bad business. Whoever perceives, comprehends that through understanding, and thereby turns away from what is ill, from what is bad, from what is wrong, this thereby becomes the path to purification. All states, all phenomena, whatsoever, are no self, are without a substance, are callous. Whoever understands that through wisdom and turns away from what is ill, from what is empty, from what is void of happiness, self, and substance, this thereby becomes surpassed to purity, to purification, to holiness, to safety, to freedom from bondage. This thereby becomes the path to Nibbana. So, the whole Dhamma is enfolded in these three statements. First, one sees that that all constructions, this means basically everything that has a cause, that is put together of something else. Construct, like the body is put together by molecules and cells and so on, energy, metabolism, and the mind is put together of consciousness and feelings and perceptions and so on. And the world is put together of countries and governments and politics and all these issues. And the universe is put together, constructed of planets, of cohesion, expansion, solidity, heat and motion. Then one understands that since it's put together of several things, then whenever one of these things goes out, then the whole phenomena falls apart, boom, gone, history. So this means that all constructions, all formations are bound to vanish, are bound to decay because of this dependency that they are put together of several causal elements or factors. So they cannot persist. It's impossible that they can persist. that they can endure in time. And because it's impossible they can endure in time, then it's very, very dangerous to cling to them and be dependent upon them as a source of one's happiness, which is what is the meaning of conscious life. The meaning. So if one is dependent upon things that are constructed, for example, the body or the mind or the world or the house or the political situation or one's bank account or one's social relations, well, then one is bound to experience unhappiness, because these things are bound to fall apart by definition, because of the inherent nature of being constructions that are very fragile. Because if just one of them, any of them, the causal factors falls down, then the whole phenomenon falls away. Boom. Gone. Whether it happened quickly or slowly, gradually or suddenly, it doesn't matter. The end result is the same. If there's clinging to this particular thing that is made of, then there will be suffering when it decays, when it crumbles, when it fades away. Like the body aging, for example, or the relationship decaying, becoming hostile, or the house becoming old, the garden becoming full of weeds, the mind becoming full of impurities, of mental defilements, just by being in contact with this world. So is seeing to this extent how waste this problem is, or vast, I should say, somebody has told me. Vast, not waste. Waste is something you put in the bin, but same thing here. Vast, like massed, this problem is. Because everything is conditioned, except one thing, that's Nibbana. That's not conditioned. It's not constructed. It's not caused. It's not put together by something else. And therefore it's not impermanent. And therefore it is the sole source of lasting and also the highest happiness. As the Buddha said, Nibbana, Paranang, Sukkang. Nibbana is the highest happiness. Okay, so far so good. It's a tall order, huh? To see this. All things are impermanent. I cannot trust it. If I rely on them, then I deposit my own future suffering when they fall apart. So I cannot rely on them. What's the purpose and the meaning of desiring something that falls apart anyway, later down the road? Yes, you can enjoy it for a short term, but as soon as you take delight in it, here and now, then there will be suffering when it goes, when it decays, when it changes and become otherwise. And it always, always do so. Usually it's because one deliberately or semi-deliberately blind oneself. I can't trust my job, my spouse, my children, my social relationship, my religious affiliation, or my house, or my economy, or my body's existence in this world. I can't trust it. Semi-trust it. I take the chance. Yes, but it's an expensive bill to take this chance, because the end result is always the same. Aging, sickness, and death. Rebirth, aging, sickness, and death. Rebirth, aging, sickness, and death. Wandering around and around and around in samsara. It have to become troublesome if one realizes it to the full extent. You and I already have been walking around in this circle, in this hamster wheel, for billions of billions of billions of cycles, billions of billions of billions of universes. Because of what? Because of not knowing the Four Noble Truths. The Noble Truths of suffering. The Noble Truth of craving as the cause of suffering. The Noble Truth of the absence of craving as the end of suffering. And the Noble Truth of the Noble Eightfold Way as a method, the path to end all suffering irreversibly. Because of not knowing that, not digging that, not comprehending that, not taking proper care of that set afore truth, absolute truth, then we are still buzzing around here in the forest, and with YouTube videos and what have you, all kinds of constructions, sankaras. So turning away means withdrawing, withdrawing out of the bog, dragging oneself up of the, out of the mud of involvement, first of all of sense pleasure, but also of all kinds of becoming and all kinds of non-becoming. So when one sees that these constructions, these sankaras, all these phenomena basically in the world, except nirvana, internal as external, past, present, or future, high or low, fine or foul, they're all the same. They're all impermanent, and therefore they're ultimately speaking suffering. Dukkha. Dukkha state. Bad states. Bad business. Bad investment. Not only waste of time, but waste of happiness. So when one sees that, as the poem says, through wisdom, through understanding, through panya, through comprehension, through repeated reflection and contemplation, one sees that to the full extent. First one sees it 1 per mil, then 1%, then 10%, then 12%, then 22%, and so on. To the extent one sees it 100%, then one's turning away from what is ill is also 100%. In the beginning, one will kind of like vacillate, then have relapses. I'll go back to the sex, drugs, and rock and roll world, and then go back here, go back and forth, a little bit there, then seek a little bit away, then go a little bit back, blah, blah, blah. Of habitually, huh? Seeking pleasure from the old sources. So, to the extent one sees it 100%, then one turns away 100% from what is ill, from what is suffering. When one moves away from what is suffering, then one obviously feels less suffering. Because one is moving away from it. One is not entangling one in it. Like a man standing with a rope in his mouth and then turning around, entangling and thereby binding himself on hands and feet. He doesn't do that. He's turning away from what is ill, from what is wrong, from what is suffering, from what is fake, from what cannot deliver what it promises. When one turns away from it, through this comprehension repeatedly, through reflection on the pillow, through hearing videos like this, through reading through these poems, through reading through this Tipitaka, the Sutta Pitaka, three times before one's life, then one gradually, edge by edge, is turning away from what is ill, from what is bad, from what is suffering, from what is a deception, from what is fake, from what is artificial. And one turns against safety, towards safety, towards what is true, towards what is honest, towards what is absolute, namely Nibbana. This is the way to purity, to purification, to holiness. This, only this. Then, instead of focusing on constructions, then one can take it one step up and say, Sabbadhamma, all states, all phenomena, including Nibbana. Everything to the truest, absolute, all-inclusive sense is without a self. There's no ego. I, me, soul, you, they, them, identity, same self, in there, or outside there. Never was, never will be. It's just passing states. One arising, going down, next arising, going down, next arising, going down. Passing states. If it's always a new state, new momentary state, new plank moment, new Dhamma, how can it be any, there be any same self in there? If nothing is the same from one moment to the next moment, how can there be any sameness in there? If there's no sameness, there cannot be anything that is identical with itself from two consecutive moments. This moment disappears, then a new moment arrives. It's like you have one flame, and then you light up another candle with that flame, and then you blow out the first flame. So the second flame is a new flame, huh? It burns, was ignited by the first flame, but the first flame is gone. So is it then the same flame, or is it another flame? That's a typical question one contemplates by seeing this no-self universal characteristic, which is a third tilakana, universal characteristic or absolute property of all phenomena. So much for the self, but there's no substance out there either. That's the same substance, an abiding thing out there. When one again sees that through contemplation, through understanding, in this case, fairly subtle understanding, also called wisdom, panya, that there's nothing in there and there's nothing out there that's the same from one moment to the next. That is permanent, that's the same in the absolute sense. Then one even more turns away from what is ill, from what is empty, from what is void of self, substance, reliance, permanence, safety, happiness. One turns completely away from it, because one realizes that it's completely silly, boring to the insane to rely on what is empty, which is like a balloon. Poof! Nothing inside. Nada. Nada. One looks back and one's reliance on all these balloons, pink balloons. Then one think, that was silly of me to rely on such thing, such evanescence, such transience, such ephemeral passing by of states, such running out of sand between your fingers, or running out of water between your fingers. You try to carry it in your horn down the beach of existence, but you never reach far before it's run out. Seeing this to the full extent, this emptiness, this voidness, sunyata, of core, of self, of substance, in all phenomena whatsoever, this drags out the last teeth, as it's the last nail in the coffin of betting on this samsara as safety, as happiness, as meaning, as something worth buzzing around in and being engulfed by again and again. It pulls out this last nail. Whack! Huh? Bye-bye, samsara. Have fun. Builder, I seen you. You're made out of craving and ignorance that build this house of existence again and again. Your reach pole is shattered. Never will you build this house again. And so one leaves the house of samsara. All constructions are impermanent. When one sees that by understanding, one leaves behind what is ill. This is surpassed purity. All formations are suffering, disappointing, dissatisfactory. When one sees that through understanding, one leaves what is ill, turns away from what is bad, then this becomes a path to purification. When one sees that all phenomena, all states whatsoever, are empty, void of self, there are no self, without any core or substance. And one sees that through profound understanding of what is difficult to understand, through wisdom, and thereby turns away from what is ill, what is empty, what is void, then this is the path to purity. To purity, mental purity, life purity, purification of the path, and thereby reaching the goal. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha who said this. Remember to click subscribe, the small bell, and like if you like, and have a nice and noble day. Silence is bliss. Indeed so.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.